वगैरे करणारच नाहीये, आपल्या सेटअप मध्ये बसतील आणि तिथूनच मीटिंग करतील. हा
नाही काय ते
टेक्नॉलॉजी होती, फक्त या कोविडमुळे जरा जास्ती वापरात आली एवढंच.
सर नाउ इट इज ऑन द वे ना सर, लिटल बिट इन महाराष्ट्र बेटर देन, इट्स नॉट दैट पीक व्हिच इज गोइंग ऑन राइट नाउ.
पीक इज गॉन डाउन, पीक इज गॉन डाउन इन महाराष्ट्र. यस यस, द नंबर्स आर डिक्लाइनिंग बट स्टिल दे आर हाई, यू हैव टू बी रियली केयरफुल. यस यस, नंबर्स आर स्टिल देयर.
नाउ म्यूकरमाइकोसिस इज अ हॉट टॉपिक नाउ अंडर डिस्कशन.
The problem with the COVID is you will get the non-oxygenated and oxygenated beds, but getting an ICU bed with the ventilator is still a big task.
Yeah.
Because we have less number of working ventilators. The expert, you know, you can't have experts in a single night. You need to nurture them for years together. And then only you can have a good intensivist who can actually utilize from it. Yeah. So that's a problem. But to make a good doctor, you need at least 10-15 years.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm-hmm.
So. Challenging time.
Yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hi, Dr. Shubhada Joshi. Welcome you in GPA afternoon academic session. Before we proceed, I request GPA President Dr. Shivaji Kole to say a few words.
Thank you, madam. Good afternoon, all. GPA-च्या आफ्टरनून स्टडी सर्कलमध्ये सगळ्यांचं स्वागत. गेले 4 वर्षापासून आपण आफ्टरनून स्टडी सर्कल चालू केलेलं आहे आणि यावर्षी आपण आठवड्यातून दोनदा म्हणजे शुक्रवार आणि गुरुवार मंगळवार असं स्टडी सर्कल कंडक्ट करत आहोत. कारण आजच्या या काळात अपडेट घेणं राहणं हे तितकंच गरजेचं आहे आणि सध्या ऍक्च्युअल आपल्याला लाईव्ह CME घेता येत नाहीये, त्याच्यामुळे आपण हे लोकांना अपडेट करण्यासाठी आणि नॉलेज अपडेशन हे खूप मुख्य काम आहे जीपीएचं, त्यामुळे त्यासाठी आपण हे लेक्चर अरेंज केलेलं आहे. त्यासाठी आपल्याकडे आज पुण्यापेक्षा बाहेरून आपण लेक्चर बोलवले आहेत डॉक्टर सोनवतीकर सर, त्यांचं आपण इंट्रोडक्शन पुढे घेणारच आहोत. तर वेलकम सर आणि थँक्यू सो मच.
मित्रांनो, आपण संपूर्ण जग हे अनेक महिने कोरोनाच्या सावटामधून जात आहे. मला वाटतं गेले काही दिवसच थोडेसे कोरोना रुग्णांची संख्या कमी होत आली आणि त्याच्यातून एक नवीन भीतीचं वातावरण परत निर्माण झालं. कारण आपण नवीन शब्द ऐकतोय म्युकरमायकोसिस, पुण्यामध्येही त्याचे बरेचसे पेशंट आलेले आहेत. नक्की म्युकरमायकोसिस काय आहे असं म्हणलं जातं की पोस्ट कोविड पेशंटमध्ये किंवा डायबेटिक पेशंटमध्ये स्टिरॉइड घेतलेल्या पेशंटमध्ये त्याचा प्रसार होतोय. तर आपल्याला बऱ्याचशा शंका त्याच्या संदर्भात आहेत. तर आपल्या सायंटिफिक कमिटीच्या मदतीने आपण नेहमीच आपलं नॉलेज स्पेशली रिलेटेड टू द करंट सिच्युएशन करंट स्टेटस आपण अपडेट करत असतो. तर या म्युकरमायकोसिस बद्दलची पूर्ण माहिती मिळण्यासाठी आज आपल्या बरोबर आहेत प्रसिद्ध ENT स्पेशालिस्ट डॉक्टर सोनवटीकर प्रवीण वितस. त्यांना त्यांची माहिती करून देण्यासाठी मी आपल्या GPA फॅमिलीचे डॉक्टर PH मस्के यांना विनंती करते. डॉक्टर मस्के सर इज BHMS अँड प्रॅक्टिसिंग इन वारजे सिन्स 20 इयर्स. ही इज अ पास्ट प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ वारजे डॉक्टर्स असोसिएशन. ही इज अ मॅरेथॉनर. सो आय रिक्वेस्ट डॉक्टर PH मस्के सर टू प्रोसीड. थँक्यू.
थँक्यू डॉक्टर जोशी मॅडम. डॉक्टर प्रवीण सोनवटीकर सर इज अ MS इन ENT and head neck surgeon. Dr. Praveen sir is director and consultant at Orion City Care Hospital at Aurangabad. He completed his MBBS from RGMC of work as DNB teacher from 2010 to 2016, 18 years post MS experience. He is being all ear, nose, throat and also head neck related benign and cancer work and mucormycosis cases. Dr. Praveen sir is invited as panelist and chairperson in state ENT conference. He is youngest and ex-president of Association of the Otorhinolaryngology in Aurangabad branch. He is one of the earliest ENT surgeons in Aurangabad to be involved in cochlear implant surgery. May I request to Dr. Praveen Sonodikar sir, please deliver our lecture.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. With the outset, let me say thank you to GPA Association, Shubhada Madam, Kole sir, and also the Michael Lab company. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity, and thank you, Maski sir, for giving a nice introduction of me. मला माहितीये पुण्याची लोक ऍक्च्युली खरंच खूप हुशार असतात आणि मी एवढा हुशार नाहीये की त्यांना काहीतरी शिकवेन, पण वी कॅन म्युच्युअली शेअर अवर एक्सपिरियन्सेस अँड ट्राय टू गेट सम इन्फॉर्मेशन आउट ऑफ दॅट विच यु नो विल बी हेल्पफुल टू मी एज वेल एज टू यू. सो आय थिंक विथ दॅट लेट मी स्टार्ट माय प्रेझेंटेशन. शुड आय?
येस सर, येस प्लीज.
So I hope everyone is seeing the presentation, right?
Yes, we can see it, sir.
So let me introduce myself. I am Dr. Praveen Sonatikar. I am MS ENT from Nair Hospital, Mumbai. And I did my head neck fellowship from Tata. So I am working in Aurangabad since last 18 years. And currently working at Orion City Care Hospital, which is owned by 10 of us. We are 10 directors. So mucormycosis is the hot topic today, as someone just said. The reason behind this is, though the mucormycosis was there previously, we would hardly see a case or two previously in a year. And mostly these cases were seen in the patients of post-kidney transplant or patients with, you know, very high dose of steroids. So where immunosuppression was expected, like chemotherapy is given for patients of leukemias or some patients of lymphomas. So mucormycosis was still there previously. We were seeing a patient or two in a year, and not much was talked in general about this disease previously. Now this disease is called as rhino-orbito-cerebral. Why? Because these are the three commonest sites which this fungus involves. So this is a rare fungal infection, and it is called by the molds, which are called as mucormycetes. And these molds live throughout the environment. They are present around us. They can be found everywhere. Even sometimes, you know, common nasal commensals, we can just get them on a swab. But not all patients get infected by this. As I just told you, the only patients who have immunosuppression in any form, say in form of COVID infection or patients on high steroids or leukemias, lymphomas, so any reason like this. And why we are discussing about this disease? The only reason is the disease has got a very high mortality and morbidity too. And this is how the fungus looks. So it is a long, non-filamentous fungus. So as I just told you, not many cases were seen previously, but especially the second COVID pandemic wave in India, we are seeing more and more patients. Like the first wave started in India around last March, but we could hardly see two or three patients in first pandemic, that too when it was ending in the month of, say, August or September. And by the time October started, the first wave faded. So we did not see much of mucormycosis last time. But yes, this time when the second wave started somewhere around the first week of February, and we are getting more and more patients of mucormycosis from the first week of March. And they are suddenly coming in very large numbers. Though in India, we have started seeing these patients. These patients are only seen in India when we are communicating with our friends, batchmates, classmates who have been to US or UK or in other countries, Australia. And nobody is saying that they have seen the increased in numbers of mucormycosis, though they have seen the second, the third, and even at some places, the fourth wave. So what is the reason? We don't know. Strain, yes. We can always blame the strain, but we don't have enough evidence-based medicine support, we call it EBM, to say that yes, the strain is the reason. Then what are the other causes which may have put the more cases of mucormycosis in the forefront? So the reason might be, are there more peripheral COVID centers who are treating? Yes. Because in first wave, only the major places, major cities right. And thing is that we are seeing the patients coming from some particular areas. Like we are seeing patients. Is it okay?
Yes.
Hello. Okay. So we are seeing patients from some particular areas, like say Nanded, Parbhani, Jalna, Bid, Latur, Jalgaon. So these are the areas from where we are seeing more and more patients, right? And what are the other causes which might be there? The steroids, yes. If patient is receiving more than 125 milligram of methylprednisolone continuously for more than 5 days, that is supposed to be a very high risk factor for mucormycosis. And COVID, high doses of steroid is a deadly combination. And to add into this, diabetes mellitus. Now, the diabetes itself is a disease which affects the large systems of the body. And definitely the diabetes with obesity, with the decreased immunity, you know, is one of the biggest predisposing factor for the mucormycosis. And what is happening is a lot of patients, they are either pre-diabetic, COVID, either because of infection per se or because of high doses of steroids. And they are having uncontrolled steroids, and especially the young population, what is happening, they're not monitoring sugars. Even after discharge, when they go home, they are not monitoring sugars because they think they are young and they don't have diabetes. And this diabetes becomes very high, say in the tune of 400, 500 sugars we are observing. And these are the patients who are getting the mucormycosis infection. Now, what are the other causes? Is industrial oxygen different from medical oxygen? The answer is yes, though we don't have enough studies to prove this. But initially, we were using medical oxygen. But since that oxygen production was not sufficient, and this time India had a record COVID patients of, say, more than 4.5 lakh patients a day, we needed more beds and more oxygen. And that's why the industrial oxygen was used. And I think it is definitely different from the medical oxygen, and we are really worried about the patients who have received the industrial oxygen. Humidifier bottles, yes. The humidifier bottles need to be clean. You need to put in a distilled water. You need to change it daily. You need to wash it daily with the lukewarm water. So a lot of care goes into the humidifier bottle maintenance. And the water of humidifier bottles, as I say, any water, tap water, you just can't put it. You have to put a good distilled water or a good quality, which is a sterile water you need to put in. And the other points are like oxygen tanks. We are not sure from where the oxygen is coming, what are the pipelines, whether they are clean, how to maintain them. So we nearly really never bothered about this previously because we are not getting patients. But since we are getting these patients, so you need to audit, you need to look back, have a retrospective study to find out what exactly it is causing. The other problems like ventilator masks, you need to use one mask for a single patient, whatever may be the cost. So patient is changed, you need to change the mask, clean the mask properly daily. Then if you are using a single mask for too many days for the patient, then you need to again change it, you know. So also I feel the person mask, I have seen lot many people, you know, they just put on a mask and they don't change it for a few days. They don't look at whether some fungus is there or not. They don't wash it. If you are using a cloth mask, you need to buy at least 3-4. So you can wash daily one, keep it, you know, to get it dry and then put the new one. So even the person mask, what we are using, whether it's a cloth one, N95, N95, whatever the mask is, we need to change it. And one more thing I have read, I'm not sure about it, is the use of vitamin C. We are all using vitamin C in all these patients of COVID, and vitamin C causes the acidic medium, and the fungus needs acidic medium to grow. So now what, as a protocol, we have decided not to use the vitamin C in all the patients of mucormycosis. So what are the patterns of presentation? We have seen mucormycosis in COVID positive patients as early as day 8 of RT-PCR positivity. And they keep on coming once they discharge from COVID wards or ICUs. And even after 4 weeks, up to 6 weeks, they are coming back saying that I have this typical facial pains like maxillary pain, the eye pain, the headache, the loosening of teeth, all those things. Okay. So what are the early complaints? The commonest would be nasal pain, anywhere near or around the nose, mainly the malar eminences between the two eyes, in the eye maybe. And patient might complain that I have tried to clean my nose, and I could find some black crust inside the nose. So this is a warning sign. And these are the early presenting symptoms to us. And when it worsens, so that causes a severe facial pain, then cheek swelling, eye pain, decreased in vision, loss of vision, eye swelling. The patients where the infection infects the brain or cavernous sinus, they can present with ptosis, loss of eye movements, we call it external ophthalmoplegia, or early sign is diplopia, severe dental pain, as I told you, loosening of teeth, black, palate, alveolus, some gets very multiple palatal perforations, even sometimes they get multiple discharging sinuses in maxilla, and the worst sign would be the headache. Now, these are the few pictures of mucormycosis. This is how it looks on endoscopy. So the moment I put my scope inside the nose, this is what I see. So this is a classical mucormycosis. This is early mucormycosis. So when I see this, I know this is mucormycosis. This is advanced disease. Patient has got proptosis, eyeball swelling, edema around it, and ptosis. Patient is not able to open the eyelid. So this is advanced case of mucormycosis with intracranial involvement. Now this, I was telling you just now that this is a palate which is involved, and I have a video I have recorded. I don't know whether I put it here or not. And if you try to move these teeth move very easily. These teeth doesn't move, but this move very easily. This crust is also a very classical sign of mucormycosis. So I just need to send this for the KOH mount, and I will get the report in 3 hours. Now, what are the choice of investigation in mucormycosis, the radiological investigations? Initially, when mucor was not there, we as ENT would always love to have a CT scan of paranasal sinuses, coronal, axial, and the sagittal cuts. So it's a complete set, coronal, axial, and sagittal cuts. Why? Because I need to say what are the air cells, what are the ways to go, where is the disease, and how I'm supposed to remove it. So that is a standard protocol for ENT. For any PNS surgeries, you need to have a CT PNS, right? But nowadays, when we are suspecting that this is a fungal infection, so MRI scores better on CT. Though CT can predict some good things in initial stages, but MRI is the gold standard. And what MRI we do? We do MRI PNS. Plain and gadolinium contrast. This is must if I am suspecting a fungal infection, especially the mucormycosis, whether it's early stage or the late stage of disease, right? And I try to add the orbit and brain diffusion weighted MRIs. See, these are words are very important. So PNS, orbit, brain. PNS and orbit with plain and gadolinium. And if I'm asking for a brain, I need to find out the diffusion weighted MRI to see the cytotoxic edema in soft tissue and bone both. So MRI will give me the best demonstration of the disease and diagnosis of the disease, right? And MRI will give you the early bone changes, the marrow edemas, the orbital involvement if it is there, how are the muscles, how is the fat, whether there is intracranial extension or not, meninges are involved or not, whether the optic nerve is involved or not, how is the condition of the pterygoperitoneum fossa. So all these things, all the nerves, everything. So that is the reason the gold standard nowadays in mucormycosis is MRI with PNS, right? And we also ask for fat suppression to see the orbit involvement. So basically, whether the periosteum is involved or not, or the fat is involved or not, or the muscles is involved or not. So MRI is very much required. Now I'm going to show you a video of the MRI. Now this patient is operated case, a young boy of 32 years old. Post-COVID, he had mucormycosis. We did a local limited palatal excision and we did the PNS clearance only on one side, that is on left side. After a few days of receiving amphotericin B, still patient had trismus and pain. So that is the reason I repeated the MRI. And what I found out was so this is the abscess, right? This is the abscess. This is the abscess. So if you see, this disease is all clear. There is nothing here. This is the maxillary sinus. These are the ethmoid sinus. Everything is out. But what is remaining is this new abscess which is created here. And this is the inferior orbital wall which shows the disease. But luckily, the first case also, we saved the patient's eyeball. And even second surgery also, we were able to save his eyeball. We just scraped the disease from this part and we remove the abscess from here. Okay. So if you see, so this is one video. And if you see the same thing, see. Now, this is the abscess which we're seeing in the coronal scans, on axial scans. What we are seeing is there is little extension behind the posterior wall of the maxilla. This is the posterior wall of the maxilla. So when we did the surgery, we had to go inside from here. From the nose only we did go inside. We drilled the pterygoid plates here. We removed the posterior wall of maxilla. We was telling that MRI is the gold standard. So in initial MRI, this infection was not there. So this is there after the second surgery. Now, what are the treatment of mucormycosis? The treatment in mucormycosis, there are only two things which we can do. One is surgical debridement. You have to debride the tissue. You have to remove the dead tissue. And the second is medical management. So we'll see surgeries followed by the medical management. Now, what are the options in surgical management? It is debridement, debridement, debridement. So like debridement of dead and infected tissues, the commonest site for mucormycosis is the middle meatus, we call it, the middle turbinate, the middle maxillary ostium, the ethmoids, and the maxillary sinuses. These are the commonest sites which are involved. After this, there will be involvement of palate, orbit, you know, alveolus, and brain. So everything comes late. But the commonest site would be this. And that is why you need to have endoscope with you to diagnose the case. And number one, once surgery done, it is not enough. You may need to take patients for repeated debridements, you know. I have just done a surgery and now everything is all right. No, no. You have to keep on washing the cavities daily post-surgery. Then you have to keep on looking into it, the endoscope in the OPD under local anesthesia. Then sometimes you may need to take the patient inside the OT and keep on debriding the current cavity, or you may need to extend your surgical domain. Like initially I did only PNS, but now I may need to remove the palate. I may need to remove the orbit. So this can happen. And this we need to explain the patient on the first go. The first time patient is coming to you, you need to tell him that these things can happen. We will try and not have, save all these things, but you cannot guarantee that this will never happen. And nasal endoscopic debridement is the most common procedure. And to remove disease from all the sinuses, as I told you, with extensions to maxilla, posterior wall, just now I have told you, the pterygopalatine fossa, the infratemporal fossa, the orbital decompression. So everything up to the brain, you have to go and do it. Now, these are a few pictures I have put. Now, this is the young male. He had these multiple sinuses, but luckily his teeth were mobile. This you can see very well, pink and very healthy mucosa. So what I did, I removed the maxilla, which was diseased. I could save all the teeth and rest of the palate. And I went endoscopically and removed the disease from the maxilla inside and the ethmoid sinuses, frontal sinuses and sphenoid. So one side, only one side disease were there on left side. Right side, there was no disease. This is another patient. He had perforation in the center. And so I had to do his hemimaxillectomy, like the left side maxilla is completely gone. So this case is different. This man is hardly 32 year old and luckily this was all normal. So I could save this. But this man was 72 year old with orbital involvement. And also we need to remove the orbit also. And we did remove the maxilla also on this side. Now this is the case. This was very early mucormycosis. But when I saw, I did the endoscopic debridement. Now this is the roof of ethmoid. You can see the black color bone here. I just crept it. I just tried to drill superficially because the moment I drill and open, this will go into the brain and I can have a CSF leak. So I have to be very careful. The last thing I want in mucormycosis is CSF leak because this can open up new avenues for the this thing to spread. Now, if you see this, this was also a young boy and he just came with this. Only this much lesion clinically. And when I send this, I just took a small biopsy of this, put it on the slide and sent to my pathologist saying that please put this under a KOH mount. And within 3 hours, I got the report that this is a mucormycosis. And I investigated the patient with MRI and it showed that there was a disease in both the sinuses, but nothing else was seen except this. This is a very early sign of mucormycosis and this is the inferior turbinate, right? Oh, sorry. This is the middle turbinate, not the inferior turbinate, sorry. So now, this is an endoscopy picture. This is in OPD I did. I'll show you. This is on, say, day one. The patient had come to meet me. COVID, DM, post-COVID, around 15 days he had come. Now, you can see the video. Now, see, what you are seeing is right side middle turbinate. This is the uncinate process and we call this middle meatus. So this is black color, pale mucosa. So this is all suspected mucor. So I took a biopsy and sent it. This confirmed the mucor. I did the MRI and put the patient for surgery, right? And what has happened, the patient was on blood thinner. So I just said that we'll stop the blood thinner and instead of today, we'll operate you tomorrow. So this is what has happened in the next 24 hours. Now you compare both, same patients. This is today. And since a patient was on blood thinners, I just said that today we will not do the surgery and next day we will do your surgery. So this is what has happened. So you can imagine how fast it can spread. And that's why we are worried. One patient came to me, the place called as Udgir. It is around 7-8 kilometers from Aurangabad. So in the afternoon, 12 o'clock, the patient started journeying. And by the time 6, 7 or 8, he reached here, he lost the vision. I mean, such a bad thing, it can happen. And this is after the surgery, what we did. Sorry. So what you are seeing is basically the sinuses, all the openings I am showing you. This is a frontal sinus. Normally, this is not seen unless you put a curved endoscope. So we have 30 degree, 45 degree, 60, 90, 70, 90 degrees. So I have put a 70 degree scope just to see that I have cleared all the disease from this area. This is called as frontal recess. And you can very well see the frontal recess here, right? So we give the amphotericin wash to the patients post surgery to clean all the disease from there. And this is again the 0 degree scope I am putting. This is after the surgery. This is a sphenoid sinus where my, so that's a skull base. This is a skull base. It is sloping from front to back, and you can see. Yeah. And this is the sphenoid sinus, you know. All the sinuses, I'm sorry. This is the sphenoid sinus. So this is the sphenoid sinus I show you. Yeah, this is the sphenoid sinus. Now this is the maxillary sinus. So this is the sphenoid sinus. This is the maxillary sinus. In between whatever it is there is called as the ethmoid sinus. So everything is clean. You can see the red blood everywhere. Nothing black and crusts are seen. So this indicates that we have completely removed the disease. Here will be the lamina papyracea, which is the bone between the ethmoid sinus and the orbit, right? So this is how it is. Now, this is a case. This is a patient with the bilateral maxillectomies. Now, this patient had a complete maxilla involved with the disease. So, we had to remove both the maxillas. Complete teeth were removed. And what you can see, now the suction is going in the right maxillary sinus. Normally, we go go into the sinus through the nose. But here, we are going through the mouth. So, this is, we are going through the mouth. So, this is the complete maxillary sinus we are seeing, right? So this is the right-sided maxillary sinus, okay? And we are going to the left-side sinus. So this is the left-sided maxillary sinus, that side of the right side. And luckily, this nasal mucosa was pink, not diseased. There was no mucor here, so I could lift it back. Otherwise, we had to remove this and we can completely see the nose from here also. But luckily, this was not the case. And if you see, that this is the soft palate. This is the only palate which is remaining. This complete palate has been removed. And then I stitched this soft palate here, here, and here. I had to take some stitches and fix it. You can see the endotracheal tube here. And this is the tongue of the patient. So now we will put the scope through the nose and we will try to see it. And now we will go inside the nose and see all the sinuses are clear, right? So both side the nose, and if you try to see, this is the septum. This is the anterior most part of the septum. This was okay, viable, but this was the posterior part of the septum which we need to remove. So right side of nose is communicated on the left side of nose, and this is the maxillary sinus on the right side, and similarly the maxillary sinus on left side also is communicated, right? So totally this is a big cavity. They're all open sinuses. Yeah. See, remember, this is the pterygoid plate. I was telling you that disease go beyond this. So this bone, we need to drill. This is the lower part of the sphenoid bone and lateral part of the maxillary bone. This is the pterygoid plates, which leads to pterygoid fossa. And the disease spreads to many places from this. So any disease we are suspecting, we need to drill this, right? And this is what I removed. This is the complete maxilla. You can see all the teeth and palatal mucosa is diseased. So we had to remove this. Now, this is the another patient. Now, this is the maxilla. So, left-sided maxilla. You can see the color. See the color of the bone. Such a bad color. No, this is not a healthy bone. What you are seeing is this is not a healthy bone. This is the inferior turbinate with the bone. So, this is really bad. And this is the eyeball of the patient. So, in some patients, we need to remove the eyeball. We call it eyeball excentration. So, we need to remove that also. Okay. Satnaye. Size kam yosti ali. Okay. So, this is another video I'll show you. So, what I was trying to show you was, this is the maxillary sinus. Now, we have seen in previous case, the maxillary sinus from below. One maxillary sinus we have seen from inside. But this disease was so big that we had to remove this medial wall of maxilla. We call it medial maxillectomy. And when we do that procedure, we call it as endoscopic maxillectomy or modified Denker's procedure. So, when we do that, from orbit, from eye, the gums, the nasolacrimal duct, which opens into the inferior turbinate, right? So, when we remove all this, we remove all the disease, we need to see that this is functioning. Because if you don't keep this pattern, then patient will have watering of eyes. Epiphora will be a permanent complaint. So, in all the cases of modified Denker's, one has to confirm that this is patent and working well, okay? So, this is cannulation of the nasolacrimal duct. So now this is another video. Yes, again frontal sinus. I think we have seen this video, the sphenoid sinus. So you need to clear the tissue till it bleeds, right? So this is the mantra of the surgery. So you need to clean it. Now, what is the work? As I told you, you need to debride patients frequently, either in OPD or in OT. You need to take patients again and again. Have a look, put the endoscope, see, and then decide whether there is a residual disease or not, whether there is a recurrence or not, whether it has spread into or not. You have to undergo a few scans just to see if patient has complaints. And at the same time, post-surgery or even before surgery, if you have time, you have to start patient on medical treatment. Now, the medical treatment lasts at least up to 4 to 6 weeks. And why? Because we need to give patient amphotericin B. Surgical debridement followed by amphotericin B is the gold standard treatment for the mucormycosis, right? Amphotericin B is a very toxic drug. It can cause a lot of problems and mainly affection would be the kidneys. So we are worried about the kidney function test. Now, amphotericin B you get in four variants in market right now. The first will be a deoxycholate, which we hardly use. Because it is in very raw type of amphotericin, and it has got very high chances of nephrotoxicity, as well as it can give rise to a lot of reactions. So we don't use deoxycholate at all, number one. Number second we get is lyophilized. This is a little cheaper version. You get an injection of 50 milligram around, say, 350 to 400 rupees. That also we avoid to use it because this is also quite strong nephrotoxic. Instead, we request patients to buy this so that they can wash the cavities post-operatively and we can put this into the nasal packs and use it. So that is the reason we usually try and avoid giving this IV. Okay. Third would be a lipid emulsion. This is much better than lyophilized and deoxycholate. This is costing somewhere around nowadays around 1500 to 1800 rupees per 50 milligram of injection. And the last one would be liposomal. Liposomal is the best out of these four. Initially, it was costing around 3,000 rupees, but now it is costing around 7,000 rupees at least. and it is not available in the market. The government is controlling all the supply of amphotericin B. So one has to request the district collector to procure it. And liposomal has got minimum kidney damage, but still it can cause. So the first day when patient comes to us, we explain all these things. Whatever I'm just now telling you, we explain all the things to the patient that you have to undergo a surgical debridement. It is a high risk procedure because patient is a post-COVID with changes in the CT and they have high sugars. So all these are risk factors. With this, giving amphotericin B in such a patient, which is quite unstable, it in itself is a bigger risk, and this can cause the kidney damage. Patient may need to undergo dialysis. We have few patients who after even liposomal amphotericin B needed dialysis. So you need to explain all these things. We can use amphotericin B either as an IV, as I told you. We prefer the central line for this because patient is going to stay back for 4 to 6 weeks and you need to give a lot of IV fluids, a lot of other drugs. So we ask patients to undergo central line, and through that we give the amphotericin B. We also can give retroorbital or intraorbital injections of amphotericin B. I don't give it. I call my ophthalmologist colleagues, and then they decide, they talk with the patients, and then they let know the patients whether this injection is needed or not. So we try to save the eye. So thing is, if eye is working well, we try to save it. If eye is not working well, we still try to save it because we don't want an empty socket there. If at all the eye is not working and still we cannot save the orbit, then only we request our ophthalmologist to go ahead do orbital excentration. So till that, we try and save with intraorbital, retroorbital orbital injections. The third thing, we use amphotericin as a wash. So we dilute it and use the wash intraoperatively, as well as when the surgery is over, we want to pack it for some time. So we put our packs in amphotericin B and use it. And after surgery, after 3-4 days, we ask patient to use the amphotericin B washes. Okay. Apart from amphotericin, posaconazole syrup tablets and injections are available. These are also not routinely available nowadays in the market. This is as costly. The single day posaconazole therapy for the adult would be 5,000 rupees, right? So if you are prescribing a liposomal injection to the patient, amphotericin B, the daily cost would be more than 21,000 rupees of only amphotericin B. If you are giving 150 milligram of amphotericin daily at least, because that is the optimal dose which patient can tolerate. You can give 50, you can give 100, 200, up to 300 you can give. But we have noticed that around 100 to 150 is good dose they tolerate and take treatment for longer period of time. And with that, if you add the posaconazole, so that is 5,000 rupees a day. So minimum posaconazole and amphotericin B is costing at least 25,000 rupees a day. It is such a costly treatment and we can't do anything because nothing is in our hands. Through our association, we have already requested the government to kindly put the prices down so maximum people can take the treatment, right? Then there is one more molecule called as isobuconazole. It can be used as IV or oral. We have not used it. Why? Because the isobuconazole cost for a first day loading dose would be 90,000 rupees for two injections. So a single injection is costing around 40 to 45,000 rupees. And the second day onwards, the subsequent cost would be at least 35,000 rupees only for a single isobuconazole injection for so many days. So it is really a problem for everyone. You know? Now, what are the things we have to be watchful to avoid mucormycosis? A lot of people ask, you know, can we give routine antifungals if we really want to avoid the mucormycosis? The answer is no. Why? Because there are some studies, like you must have read here. There are some studies which says that, in fact, if one gives the voriconazole drug, which is antifungal, it itself can cause the significant consequences of immunosuppression leading to mucormycosis. So the first thing we request our physician friends or our all the doctors, you know, who are treating COVID, we request them, please do not prescribe the voriconazole. Also, we request them not to prescribe vitamin C. As I told you, it can cause the acidic medium where the mucor grows, right? And second thing, when we all do these things, we have to monitor the kidney function test. Daily, we send the kidney function test reports and monitor, and then only we decide whether to give the amphotericin B or not and how much we can give safely. Number three, we also monitor electrolytes. Amphotericin B itself causes the hypokalemia. In fact, one of our patients had a hypokalemia in a day and he presented with atrial fibrillation. So we took patients into the ICU, but then we did the electrolytes, we corrected that and all that improved. So, you know, we have to be really watchful, and the electrolytes are always related with magnesium, specifically the potassium. So magnesium is also important in case of potassium. Now we have to also watch the CBC. If patient is fine, stable, you don't do daily CBC. By every third, fourth, fifth day, you have to do the ABC, CBC, because this mucor affects the ferritin. This mucor thrives on ferritin. So this is a chronic disease also. Patient is taking long-term treatment. So what we have observed is most of the patients after 2-3 weeks, they end up having low-side hemoglobin. In fact, one of my patients yesterday, we give 2 bloods and today 1 blood. He was not bleeding from anywhere, but anemia took him down. You know, he was feeling pale, weakness. So this you have to monitor along with the KFTs. Also, the third thing you will notice is all the amphotericin patients, they will keep on complaining about fever. They will get chills, they will have fever. There are two reasons. One, definitely they get thrombophlebitis because of the different IV lines, or if you're infusing them through the central line, that can cause a fever. But the amphotericin B, one of the side effects is the fever. So you may not find anything on blood cultures, everything. But patients will get fever and chills intermittently. We just give Advil, give a paracetamol tablet, 650 milligram, or if required, we can give the paracetamol injection 1 gram. But try and avoid giving the steroids. No hydrocortisone injection, please, because this is a mucor mycosis patient, already diabetic, immunocompromised. So please avoid giving steroids, right? And as I told you, we put patients on center line because peripheral lines get fired very quickly and you need to give it at least 4 weeks. So that is the reason. And if dialysis also required, center line is always better. Now, the biggest thing about the mucor is I, as an ENT and single person, I can't handle this case. It has to be managed by team. And what team? I need a physician intensivist. I need a nephrologist. I need an ophthalmologist. I need a dentist. Why I need a dentist? Because as I showed you, if I remove the palate, if I remove the teeth, then right now, though I am not thinking of rehabilitation, but once the patient becomes all right, I need to give him something at least to put it there. And during stay also, if patient wants to eat, if my dentist puts a good plate there, he can eat it, then he can remove it and clean and wash the wound. And later on, either I can do myself or call my plastic guy to completely close it later on, or we can fix in some bone and put teeth there. So all this can be done, but we have to think it right from now. So that is why the dentist is needed in the team, right? So mucor mycosis rehabilitation is very important. So in initial phase, when we do the surgery, so before surgery, we ask our dentist to come and take the record the impression. So immediately after surgery, in 3-4 days of time, when the edema subsides, they give a temporary prosthesis. I'll just put you a picture of that here. And they provide us a prosthesis for the palate and maxilla. As I told you, later on, we can always do a flap closure, which will be a permanent closure. Then in some patients, when you do the eyeball excentrations, you need to fill in that socket. So either you can give an eyeball prosthesis later on. Also, you need to give some soft tissue cover if the bone is really open and dry, because these dry, desiccated bones die on later on and they can be really troublesome. So you have to think all those things, right? So this is the thing I was talking about, the prosthesis. Now, this is the photo we have seen. This is a left maxillectomy patient and endoscopically debridement has been done. This is the inferior turbinate on the left side. This is the maxillary sinus. And then this side patient had teeth on right side. So they put a prosthesis like this. So this prosthesis help patients gaining the confidence, having food after 3-4 days of surgery. They can have a good food with this prosthesis. The cavities don't get infected or soiled. And this can be removed and wound can be cleaned. So all these things are needed, right? So with that, I think I would say a big thank you to all of you. I tried to cover everything. So two things are very important in mucormycosis: early diagnosis, watchfulness, and ENT has to put a scope immediately if there is a doubt. I can do it in my OPD. It takes 5 to 10 minutes for me to put my scope, see if there is any suspicion lesion. I can take a biopsy, send it on a slide, and KOH mount. This will diagnose the patient in 3 hours. And during those 3 hours, I can get done his MRI, PNS with gadolinium in contrast. Early intervention, frequent intervention, good long-term treatment by a team of doctors. We can definitely try and cure as many patients as possible. With that note, I would say thank you to all of you. Thank you.
Sir, there are a few questions.
Yes, ma'am. Just
now you said ki early diagnosis, but for we as a GP, is there any specific test to diagnose, or we have to diagnose it with the help of physical examination?
Okay, ma'am. Like this, if patient is coming to you with a definite history of COVID in recent past, number one. Number two, either they had raised sugars during COVID treatment or post-COVID treatment. If they have atypical and very prominent and persistent facial pains, you know, loose teeth, black palate, malar pains, bilateral nasal pains, eye pains, headache, these are all watchful signs for us to consider that this patient can be of mucormycosis, right? So this is clinical. The second important thing is then to put the scope inside the nose and see. And third is MRI.
Okay, sir. Another thing I want to ask, sir, how to know that mucormycosis is an emergency? Because you show so many videos. So how to know?
Okay, I'll tell you. Mucormycosis is always an emergency. It is always an emergency. Once I have a suspicion or once I have diagnosed that this is a mucormycosis, it is an emergency. Emergency, what I mean to say is, if I diagnose a patient today, then I need to make sure that by the time tomorrow he is operated. If possible today, if not possible, then at least tomorrow I try and operate him. I don't have time saying that, no, 2-3 days I'll stop, 5 days I'll stop, then I'll operate. No, that will lead the infection to spread beyond the limits and we may lose a patient which we could have saved. Now, the only problem with this is if patient is already COVID positive on 6th, 7th day and a patient has got very high IL-6 levels, patient is in cytokine storm, patient is very high risk. So that is the only time if I don't have a dedicated COVID OT. I need to have a separate dedicated COVID OT for RT-PCR positive patient to operate. If I don't have that, that is the only time where we can put patient on amphotericin B injections and posoconazoles. Otherwise, if patient is not in the storm, he has already completed his quarantine or whatever days and his antigen or RT-PCR negative, you need to operate patient as early as possible.
Okay. So one more question from Dr. Anwar. Is iron therapy is a risk factor?
Ferritin, yes. The mucor grows on ferritin. And one of the logic behind growing mucor in post-COVID patients is when a person gets infected with the COVID, the initial phases, the iron is retained inside the cells. And so the ferritin levels will not be high. But once the COVID decreases, all this ferritin, which was stored inside the cell, it comes out into the serum. And that's why when you do the serum ferritin, the levels will be high. And here are the chances that patient may get mucormycosis. So yes, iron therapy can cause mucormycosis, but we have to be a little careful in prescribing the iron. Definitely, yes.
Sir, next question from Dr. Anushree. In which period after COVID it occurs?
Yeah, as I told you, we are seeing as early as on day 8th of RT-PCR positivity from that day to even say patient was initially RT-PCR positive, but now patient has completed treatment, and even after up to 1 month post-COVID discharges, we are finding patients having mucor. The biggest problem is they have to monitor their sugars. Sugar monitoring is must. Personal hygiene is must. So all these are important things.
Dr. Ashish wants to ask the role of psychiatrists for the sake of counseling. Do you feel it is important?
Yes, it is important in two aspects, I'll tell you. Because one is patients are very anxious. I have seen too many patients coming to me. They don't have any disease, but every fourth, fifth day they keep on coming me telling that doctor, ithe dukhtay, asa zala mala COVID zala hota, ani mag mala mucormycosis tar nahi ka. Because all media, all the WhatsApp group, everywhere it is there, mucormycosis. Mm-hmm. So it is getting into the psyche of those patients. And yes, definitely, some of them, they definitely need counseling. And number two, I have patients who, once you diagnose them with the mucormycosis, they are all educated. They have read so much about the mucormycosis. So obviously, they go into depression. So here also, you may need the help of a psychiatrist. And third thing is, I have a patient whom I have operated. The patient had a right-sided eye blindness since ages. He's 72 years old and 30 years he's blind from right eye. And now mucormycosis has involved his left eye and we had to do the orbital excentration. So the poor soul has become completely blind and he's so much depressed that it doesn't move from his place. So he's the patient to whom I told my psychiatrist to please meet, have talk and try to encourage him. Yes, definitely. There is a role of psychiatrist. I'm not getting your sound nicely. Pardon?
Means in the team we need psychiatrists also, I think.
Yeah, definitely. We need psychiatrists also. Definitely we need psychiatrists. Yeah, right. In the team you need psychiatrists. Yeah. Right.
So you said actually steroids are not advisable.
No, I think the interpretation was wrong. I'll tell you how it is.
Dr. Bhushan wished to ask which drugs apart from steroids can lead to develop the mucormycosis.
Okay, the biggest culprit is the steroids. Yeah, steroid raises your blood sugar and it suppresses the immunity. So that's why steroids are the mainstay. But I'm not saying that don't give steroids in COVID. No. Those who really need, one has to give the steroids. So whenever it is indicated, one need to give steroid, but they have to make sure that the sugars are controlled really well. You just can't keep on giving steroids and not controlling sugars. That is not pardonable. Wherever is needed, one has to give steroids in COVID. So let me clear. You have to control sugars with that. The second drug apart from steroids would be the tocilizumab. This is used in cytokine storm. So basically it suppresses your inflammatory reactions, but thereby suppressing your immunity. So I'm worried in patients of high doses of steroids and tocilizumab. So both these drugs.
Dr. Manisha wants to ask, after mucormycosis, if anemia is there, then what is the treatment?
Okay. So, as I just discussed, after mucormycosis, if anemia is around 8, 9 and not lower than that, patient is moving around well, eating good food. So, you can just prescribe a lower dose of lower dose of ferritin, right? That you can give. But if patient is having less than 6-7 Hb with pitting edemas and pale pallor and patient is having weakness, then this is the time one has to make sure that is not bleeding from somewhere. And once that is confirmed, yes, you need to give him the blood, the PCVs, tactile volume.
Yes. Question from Dr. Priya Sonone. Is this contagious?
No, this is not contagious. Mucormycosis is not contagious. As I told, mucormycosis is there everywhere in the atmosphere, right? Even I may be harboring, if my nose swab is taken, it may show a mucormycosis. The only thing is, doesn't get infected because I try to maintain my immunity. So I don't have diabetes. I don't have uncontrolled sugars. I don't have COVID at present. So all these things, you know, I'm not a kidney transplant. I'm not on immunosuppression. I'm not on steroids. So all these things favor and protect me from getting a mucormycosis infection.
Okay. The question from Dr. Baumeister, what as a GP, what we should advise to the patient to avoid mucormycosis?
Okay. As I told you, you know, you need to monitor the sugars. You need to give minimum or required doses of steroids. Patient has to maintain his personal hygiene, you know, clean surrounding, clothes, mask, walls, everything, you know, no fungus around in the vicinity. So all these things they have to maintain, and watchful symptoms, you know, any abnormalities, discomfort, pain, which is not managed by simple medications, one has to immediately report. You can, there are no specific drugs to prevent this. But like personal hygiene and all these things, if you maintain sugars, then you are less likely to have an infection of mucor.
Sir, but is it curable?
Okay, the first slide, as I told you.
Sir, two extreme questions. Means, is it life-threatening and is it curable?
Okay, this is a life-threatening disease. That's why we are talking about it right now, right? All media is talking, everybody is talking. So it is definitely a life-threatening disease. At present, around 60% of patients may die because of mucormycosis. So it is a life-threatening disease. So when you complete the treatment with surgical debridement and amputation B, then chances of survival of patient are into the tune of 40%. And that is why everybody is worried. If you see in COVID, 95% patients survive. In mucormycosis, only 40% survive. So there is a vast difference of survival rates between two of these. And that is why everybody is worried about mucormycosis.
Dr. Nitin Dhankar wants to ask, shall we avoid vitamin C in all diabetic patients?
Not exactly, but what was happening, you know, in initial stages, you can keep in initial stages. If sugars are controlled, you may give it for first few days. Like patient when is in active COVID, you are treating them, please do give vitamin C. You can give the limited dose, but people are continuing it for months together, like 2 months, 3 months, they are continuing. So try avoid doing that. Few days, yes. Steroid also, I said, whenever is required, one can give the steroids, but you have to see the optimum doses, use it judiciously and make sure that even if you are using steroids, the sugar should not be high. That's all.
Sir, it's not a question, but एक opinion विचारायचं होतं. आजच्या सकाळच्या पेपरला आलेलं आहे की mucormycosisला साथीचा आजार म्हणायचा आहे. त्याच्याबद्दल काही सांगू शकता?
This is a government, I think, GR, right? Why government did this? Because the logic is more of a, administrative, that they want to have a reporting of all the diseases, all the cases from all the places, you know. So once government put it in, under that category, then everybody needs to inform to the central government. So I think that is the only reason. This is a fungal infection, yes, but this is not contagious. Like COVID is contagious. We never say that mucor is contagious. So it is not like that. It's not like that. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Too many questions are striking to our mind, and I think you fulfill maximum of our queries. But then also we wish ki we need your guidance again and again. Yes, sir. Thank you very much for very much informative session, which is very much necessary for especially during this period. So once again, thank you to you. I request Mr. Jairaj sir from Micro Lab to say few words. Over to you. Either Jairaj sir or Tubhash Shah.
Good evening, ma'am. Jairaj sir is attending some other similar sort of ongoing meeting from AIG Hyderabad. So on behalf of MicroLab, I would be giving the vote of thanks. Thanks a lot, GPA Pune Association, for giving us this opportunity for doing these three lectures. And this is the last one. But this is one of the most important one because today it is the burning topic, mucormycosis. And thanks a lot for GPA Pune as well as Kolle sir for giving this opportunity, as well as all the members from GPI Association. And I'm very much thankful for Dr. Praveen Sonwatikar sir for giving this nice informative lecture, which is the current very much required. I'm sure this lecture, this sort of lectures will get continued in the years to come, and definitely we will also take part in future course also. Once again, thanks a lot for giving this opportunity.
Yes, yes. Thank you, Shah sir, and thank you, Metro Labs. Yes, thank you very much. And
thank
once
you.
Again, thanks to Praveen sir also.
Thank you.
Dr. Maske sir for your contribution. And thanks Mr. Piyush for technical support. Thank you, Scientific Committee Chairman Dr. Mahesh Vayal and Dr. Sanjay Vak for guiding us to conduct such lectures. And thank you, dear all attendees. And please attend all the lectures to update ourselves. Thank you once again, all of you, and have a great day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.